Good evening. My name is Paul O'Neill. On behalf of Kingston's Buried Treasures, we'd like to welcome you to tonight's presentation in our lecture series. The subject tonight being From Dutch to English, the Conquest of Kingston. And we are actually celebrating tonight the commemoration of the 350th anniversary of the English takeover of New Amsterdam from the Dutch. Yes, I can see. There's a lot of excitement. The actual anniversary is Monday, August 18th. August 18th was the day that the English sailed into New York Harbor and without a shot won New Amsterdam, changing the name to New York in honor of James, Duke of York. He was the brother of King Charles, and New York was a gift to him, not a bad gift. I know, I'll tell you, I haven't gotten one of those from my brother. But it's really one of the signal events in our history, and it really has come with very little fanfare. And that's very strange, and it's very inappropriate. So we are going to change that tonight. And we are very fortunate to have as our featured presenter Ann Gordon. Ann Gordon is our Ulster County historian, and she's also a proud member of Kingston's Buried Treasures. So Ann has really been banging the drum for the commemoration of this event, because it is truly an incredibly important event in our history, not only for New York State, but it had significant repercussions here in Kingston. So without further ado, it is a great pleasure and an honor to introduce our featured presenter tonight, Ann Gordon.
Thank you. Can everyone hear me? Am I speaking into the right microphones? Yeah. Well, usually I'm sitting in the audience at these events, but I have been at the podium before, and it's always a pleasure to come back. You're such a knowledgeable group. Sometimes it seems presumptive to give these lectures. In 2011 was the 150th anniversary of the Civil War, the beginning of the Civil War. And New York State government said, well, what's the big deal? We don't have any money, we're not gonna celebrate it. Thanks to people like the Civil War roundtables all around the state, and the local historians, and some far-sighted museums, there was a celebration of the war in fairly minor terms, but still worth attending. The state historian mounted an exhibit at the State Museum in Albany on the Civil War that was absolutely first rate, a wonderful, wonderful event. So thanks to him for doing that. But he's not doing anything this year. I called him and asked him, and he said, well, what are you doing? And I said, I'm doing a one-woman lecture tour because I really feel this is an important event. It's like a landmark event for New York State. And part of its history which has been neglected shamefully. And there are a number of reasons for that, and I'll tell you what they are as I get into my talk. Okay, here, just outside the painting, over here, is Henry Hudson's ship. And these are the Native Americans' first glimpse of the Dutch coming up the river. And perhaps this picture was done at sunset for a very good reason. It's a commentary of the ultimate fate of the native people along the Hudson River. Here's a quick review of what was taking place with the Dutch and English rulers during the 1600s. The Netherlands, after 40 years of war, had thrown off their Spanish oppressors and united the seven provinces into the Dutch Republic. They were well known for their tolerance of foreigners, religious differences, and new ideas. Leadership came from the Staats-General, with a representative from each of the provinces. The military leadership came from the Stadtholder, usually a prince of the House of Orange. In England during this period, the leadership changed from Charles I to Oliver Cromwell, to Charles II, James II, and William and Mary. The official religion of the country changed from Catholic to Puritan to Catholic to Protestant. What the two countries had in this era of exploration and trade was a great hunger to control the prosperous North and South Atlantic trading routes. When Henry Hudson sailed up the Cohohatia, the River of the Mountains, in 1609, he was looking for a quick route to the East Indies. He didn't find that. But what he did find was, quote, as fine a river as could be found, wide and deep, a very good harbor for all winds, unquote, and a report of an unlimited supply of timber, fine furs of all sorts. By 1625, on the island of Manhattan, the Dutch West Indies Company had established a settlement called New Amsterdam. Its main goal was to earn profits by exporting beaver skins and other American goods to Europe. And this is a very interesting map. First of all, this is north over here, south over here. Here you see the Hudson River, Long Island, and that little blob is Manhattan. But it's also illustrated. The text is in Latin and Dutch. And here the text says, these are Native Americans in canoes made of tree bark. And this is a canoe made of a hollowed out tree. And you can see at the top and sides of the map, turkeys, beavers, foxes, mink, all the things that could be found here. Right up here is what became Albany, which was Fort Orange. And somewhere in here is Esopus. And then down here was New Amsterdam. The reason this area was called Esopus was because of the creek that ran through it. And the Dutch, in their wisdom, named the Indians the Esopus Indians because they lived alongside the creek. With the two settlements of Esopus and Fort Orange or Beaverwijk, plus five towns on Long Island, the northern part of the Dutch colony stretched from Albany in the north to the Delaware Bay in the south. It included all or parts of what became Delaware, New Jersey, Connecticut, Pennsylvania, and New York. Although founded by the Dutch, this hub of commerce attracted a population that included a large variety of nationalities. Its citizens valued free trade and individual rights. And here's early New Amsterdam. And you can see here is the windmill that drew the water up. Here is the stadthouse where it was like the city hall. Next to it is the fort. And this structure here is not a gallows, but actually a derrick for helping to unload the ships. New Amsterdam became one of the most important way stations on the Atlantic trading circuit, famous for its vibrant polyglot culture. The varieties of religions astounded new arrivals. Calvinists, both French and Dutch, Catholics, Lutherans, Anabaptists, and Jews. There was one specific aspect of life that was brought over from the New Netherlands, the legal system, known as Roman Dutch law. It was a judge-based civil law, a merger of Roman law and Dutch feudal law. Cases were determined by magistrates or appointed arbitrators. This law gave women the rights of citizens. A woman kept her family name, had the right to own property and dispose of it as she chose. She could set the terms of her own will, sign contracts, and engage in business. And believe me, New Amsterdam was full of businesses run by women. Her husband had no legal power over her, had no right to physically abuse her or to compel her to have sex. The situation under Roman Dutch law for slaves in this new land was unusual. Slaves began to arrive in New Amsterdam 1 year after the village was founded. To address the severe labor shortage, The Dutch were already in the Atlantic slave trade, providing labor for their sugar plantations in the Caribbean. The status of slaves in the colony was ambiguous. It was not considered to be a permanent condition, nor was it based entirely on race. Africans were allowed to join the Reformed Church, be married there, and have their children baptized. Intermarriage was not unknown. They could assemble in large groups, own property, and move freely about the town. If they could earn enough money, they could buy their own freedom. And after fighting in the 1644 war against the Algonquins, African soldiers were declared free men and given farmland. Up the river from Manhattan, a handful of dissatisfied settlers moved down from Fort Orange and Beaverwick and established themselves in the area known as Esopus, on land that they bought from the Esopus Indians. The Esopus was a very large tract of land which lay along the Esopus Creek, very fertile. The colony of Esopus extended west and north to the two branches of the Delaware River and east along the Hudson, and included a part of what is now Dutchess County. It lay midway along the Hudson between Beaverwick and New Amsterdam. These settlers were Dutch farmers and an Englishman or two who chafed under the rule of the patroons of Rensselaerwyck. And this is a picture of a very prosperous pair of Dutch farmers, husband and wife. You can see they're not dressed as aristocrats. They're just ordinary working people. This is a view taken actually from Brooklyn looking towards New Amsterdam. But the basis of the wealth is what you see down here, slaves. And what are these rolled up things? Tobacco, shipped from the Virginia plantations to be then shipped out of the harbor at New Amsterdam. It was a very important part of keeping the colony prosperous. The Dutch and English farmers in Esopus lived on separate farms a few miles inland near the rich farming land along the Esopus Creek. The colonists had a troubled relationship with their Native American neighbors, and attacks by the natives and retaliation by the farmers resulted in two wars. Finally, in an order by Stuyvesant in 1658, all farmers were instructed to move into a settlement on land which he purchased from the Esopus Indians, and a stockade was constructed for their protection. And this document has to do with the agreement of the town government to construct this stockade or else pay a fine of 1,000 guilders. That is a big fine. These early farmhouses that were scattered along the banks of the Esopus were built of wooden timber frames filled in with a mixture of mud, straw, and reeds. And the roofs were either thatched or sod. Chimneys, when they existed, were often made of sticks or mud. It was easy to pull them apart, move them up the hill, and re-erect them and put in new mud walls. Stuyvesant arranged for a team of 12 engineers to come down from Beaverwick to help with the move, and it was accomplished very quickly. At first, the settlement was under the jurisdiction of the court of Beaverwick. However, in 1661, a formal charter was granted to Wiltwyck, as it was known, by Stuyvesant, which decreed that the settlement should have a small bench of commissaries or shepherds and a sheriff called a shout to govern it. The basis of their administrative rule was Roman Dutch law. And here's a picture of the stockade in various points in its history. Thanks to Ted Dietz, we know all about the stockade. And Ted tells us that this was the first part that was built right here in 1658. Then over here in 61, they added this part. And then finally, this part was also enclosed later on. A village house was built, and Ted says it was right here. It contained a meeting room for the court and for the church services, residence of the minister, and a debtor's prison. Eventually, there would be several breweries, a blacksmith, a mill for grinding meal. Here, unlike Manhattan, the only language was Dutch, and the only religion was the Dutch church. There were a lot of problems facing these colonists. First of all, their houses seemed to catch fire very easily. There were depredations by packs of wolves, sickness, drunkenness, constant disputes between neighbors and between the commissaries and the consistory of the church. I don't think Kingston has changed an awful lot. Maybe the houses don't burn down quite so frequently, but who knows? There was little communal feeling and no political interest, perhaps because the form of government allowed for little political representation or control. All decisions had to be approved by the Director General and by the States General back in Amsterdam. In 1664, Stuyvesant finally signed a peace treaty with the Native Americans, and a later version of that treaty was commemorated with the wampum belt, which you can see today in the county archives. In the meantime, pressure from Europe was building due to the Anglo-Dutch War. And here we come again, that monster of who controls the trade routes in the Atlantic. This was the first of three Anglo-Dutch wars, fought mostly at sea, a struggle to control the maritime trade. Rumors spread of an invasion coming from Connecticut and Long Island, where there were English towns. Then came news of English warships sailing from Portsmouth. In August, they arrived in the harbor, and armed men from the English towns of Long Island and Connecticut lined the Brooklyn shore. It was an ominous sight. At that moment, Stuyvesant received a petition from the leading merchants and citizens of New Amsterdam, asking him to, quote, advert misery, sorrow, and conflagration, unquote. The town was low on food and gunpowder, and the people were not willing to fight. They were a practical people and knew they had little choice, a weak militia, and no hope of military assistance from Amsterdam. Colonel Richard Nicolls, the English commander, presented the terms of surrender to the Dutch. They were called the Articles of Capitulation. And very cleverly, he had them printed and distributed in a handbill to all of the population of New Amsterdam so that everybody knew what was being offered. The 23 specific articles, which I won't read to you, contained some of these following points. Those who wished to remain could keep their property, maintain their customs and traditions, and were only required to take an oath of allegiance to the British Crown. Under this agreement, Dutch merchants were made denizens of England with the ability to travel and trade in all parts of the British Empire. This was important because it enabled them to keep their highly lucrative trade shipping tobacco from the plantations in Virginia. This is 1660, New Amsterdam. Here's the wall, which became Wall Street. And look at this big, wide street, Broadway, it's still called that today. And this little street has a canal going up the middle, Canal Street. So that's, you know, look what remains of our Dutch heritage. It's right there on the land. And this is James II. He is, as Paul said earlier, he was the brother of King Charles II, and then later became James II. Here he is in his garter robes. Many changes began to take place after the British takeover. Charles II had gifted the entire North American region to his brother, James, Duke of York, who had great plans for a British empire. By August, the takeover was a fact, and the residents of the Esopus region were anxious. The scout and the commissaries passed a resolution on September 4th, resolving that if the English approached the village, the cannon would fire and everyone would report to the head of the watch. Meanwhile, the officials would wait outside the gate to parley with the English. They made a list of all the gunpowder and shot on hand, and later the colonists were instructed to send all their ammunition down to the city, but they sent a letter declining to do so. The first arrival of the occupation force were English soldiers under the command of Captain Daniel Broadhead, ostensibly to protect the village from native attacks. They were boarded in village homes and treated their hosts with abuse and contempt. The court records show constant instances of threats, physical abuse, theft, and property damage. The result was the Esopus Mutiny. 70 armed men came into the street besieging the court, demanding the release of a local man. The incident ended without injury, and it was resolved in a hearing where many complained about the violent abuse they had suffered under Captain Broadhead and his men. Broadhead was relieved of his command and eventually stayed here. He had brought his family with him when he came over from England. He was going to stay. But the rowdy behavior continued for 2 more years. It was finally resolved when the garrison was dismissed and disbanded. Land had been set aside, and 30 English soldiers were given 30 acres each in Marbletown. At that same time, Wildwick's name was changed to Kingston, and Newdorp became Hurley. But the events of 1664 are not quite the end of the story of the Dutch in America. After all, they didn't leave. They stayed here, and the second part of the Anglo-Dutch War had already commenced. In 1673, the Dutch retook New York, sailing up into New York Harbor. This time, the surrender on the part of the British avoided bloodshed as well, and New York was given a new name, New Orange. Beaverwick, which had been named Albany, became Willemstad, and Kingston became Swanenwick. And this map, it's much later map, but it just shows you the large size of this province, which became the county of Ulster in 1683, when 10 counties were organized up and down the Hudson River. And they were all given names reflecting the royal family, the Duke of York. Ulster was a duchy in the province of James, the Duke of York. Duchess was named after his duchess, and so on and on. However, 15 months after this takeover, a peace treaty was signed, and the colony reverted back to English control. And at that time, the British instituted a punishment that was unique in the history of the British Empire. This was the change in the basis of the laws. English common law was now in effect. The jury system was established, 12 men chosen by the court, both civil and criminal matters. The changes in the status of women was dramatic. English common law saw husband and wife as one person, and that person was the husband. All property which a wife held at marriage became the possession of her husband. All legal rights were subsumed by the husband. A wife could not own or inherit property. She could not sign legal documents or enter into a business. There was also a dramatic change in the situation of people of African ancestry. The Duke of York was a shareholder in the Royal African Company. This enterprise became the greatest shipper of slaves to the New World. Thousands were brought every year to expand the free labor force on southern plantations and northern farms. In 1665, a law recognized the legal status of slavery. Later laws took away any attempts by African people to get out of slavery. A curfew was established. They were not allowed to meet in groups of more than two. They were not allowed to testify at trial unless they could prove they were free. It just went on and on. These legal actions reflected the growing size and economic importance of the African population in the New York colony. By 1712, enslaved Africans made up 15% of the population of the 10 counties. The slave code of New York was stricter and more coercive than any other on the eastern seaboard, and that included the southern states. The form of local government had changed as well. After 1669, Governor Lovelace appointed a commission to govern Esopus. It appointed a surveyor general to regulate the highways for the three towns and an officer over the Indians. And here we begin to see the rise of civil service. It's very interesting. They were ordered to govern by English laws and set a watch at the redoubt. The structure of the law was the justice of the peace and a court of sessions consisting of one commissary from each village. Instead of meeting every 2 weeks as under the Dutch, the court met only twice a year. Numerous offices were created under the new law. Peace treaties with the natives resulted in the growth of farms outside of the settlements. People moved out onto their own lands and lived in safety. The early history of Esopus was certainly dramatic. Two Indian wars, three changes of allegiance in 23 years, made life stressful and difficult for people who were trying to develop a stable community. It certainly was a ban to immigration and settlement. And in addition, there were four separate groups, each trying to preserve its own language and customs: Indians, Dutch, English, and French. The tension among these groups were not resolved until long after 1675, but it was longer than that until the Dutch language and customs were no longer in use. In fact, I don't think that day has ever really arrived. The reason we know so much about these early struggles is due to the discovery and translation of early Dutch records. Sadly, much has been destroyed or missing. In 1821, the Dutch government sold for scrap paper the entire records of the Dutch West India Company. What? The records of the colony here in New York have been kicked around, fought over, survived travels on sailing ships and stagecoach, faced fire and water and eccentric translators. They survived the 1911 fire at the State Library in Albany simply because they had been stuffed away on bottom shelves out of everybody's sight. And when the fire took place and the shelves caved in, they protected the records. So that was good luck. However, when a vast 12,000-page collection was found at the State Archives in the 1970s, the search began for a translator who could not only deal with the crabbed language change, the 300 years of language changes, the difference in terms of measurement, and obsolete types of money. Fortunately, Dr. Charles Gehring was found, and he has so far published more than 18 volumes of translations, with more to come. And as for Ulster County, we are more than fortunate to have the Kingston Papers, the original records of the court at Wiltwyck, and this is record number one, setting up the court, 1661. And today they are in the wonderful care of our county clerk and in the county archives. These court minutes and secretary's papers record hearings, trials, legal and administrative transactions, land use, trade, and security matters. They have also had a series of adventures before they came to rest in our county archives. In 1855, they disappeared completely. And they had been over in the county court, and nobody knew where they were. But in the 1880s, a man on Long Island said, "These were taken for safekeeping, but I think it's time they came back to Ulster County." And so they did. They have survived to become valuable sources of historical and genealogical information. These papers together tell the story of a vital step in America's beginnings, before the story of the 13 colonies. It's a story which has been ignored, a European colony whose history was all but erased when the English took over New York in 1664. Thank you. I just have an addendum. I've been asked what happened to the native people who first lived here. The Dutch call them the Esopus Indians. They call themselves the Lenape, the people. They were members of the large Algonquin nation, and their language was a variation of the Algonquin tongue. After being devastated by disease, cheated of their lands, and used as pawns in several wars, King Philip's War, French and Indian War, American Revolution, and the Civil War, the Lenape people are scattered across the US and Canada. They have been displaced more times than any other native nation, having been driven from New York, New Jersey, Delaware, Eastern Pennsylvania, to Missouri, Kansas, Oklahoma, and Ontario. About 35,000 live in Oklahoma as part of the Delaware Nation. The Esopus people, after the Revolutionary War, fled to Ontario, where they joined the Munsee. A few families remained and are now part of the Ramapo Lenape Nation on the borders of New York and New Jersey. For more information about these local native people, I invite you all to visit the current exhibit at the Klein Esopus Museum called The First People. It's really a fascinating exhibit and full of hundreds and hundreds of projectile points and tools. So that's my addendum. Thank you.
Do we have any questions for Ann?
Yes.
If we do, I'll just...
You can... When you said the names of the counties changed after the English took over.
There were no counties.
Well, I just noticed on your map there.
That's the 1770 map, that's why.
No, but how did Orange County remain Orange County?
That was another one of the Duke's provinces of Orange.
Oh, I see.
Oh, maybe it was named after the Duke, the Prince of Orange.
So it didn't remain, it wasn't a Dutch name?
No. They, all of them, Columbia, Richmond, Suffolk, Nassau, all those kings, queens, they were all named after the British royal family and their relatives. So.
And the first 10 counties were named in 1683.
Right.
So it was after the takeover by about 20 years.
I'm a little bit wondering why the English, or why the Dutch gave over the whole colony to the English and then they gave it back. Why didn't they go to war? I mean, they were fighting all the time in Europe.
Yes, well, the Dutch West India Company didn't have large troops of men stationed here. So the only people that would eventually go to war would be the local militia or trained bands. And it didn't amount to much when you put it up against what the British Navy was going to land on shore. I mean, those ships were loaded with soldiers. And at that time, the attention of the Dutch was being pulled away from North America by what was going on in Europe, because they were having a huge fight with France over who would own the two remaining Spanish colonies in Northern Europe, Brussels and some part of France. And so they were going to war there right away. You know, their attention was being pulled away from here.
Yeah, and after the 1664, when they transfer, that the spoils of New York were determined in Europe, and they, all the countries were battling. The transfer back to the Dutch was as a result of the wars in Europe, and the transfer back was the same. So we were kind of a volleyball in the middle of the European powers at that time.
You have any other questions?
When the American Revolution started, when the American Revolution started, I would imagine most of these Dutch people signed right up
Is that the case? You know, when?
Oh, yes, indeed.
Yeah, and of course, yes, they were.
Well, you only have to look. If you go back and read Sylvester's History of Ulster County, he lists every single person that was in the militia. And, you know, there was a whole section of the militia that were all Dutch names, right. Another section that were all English names, Dutch. Dutch commanders.
So that was an opportunity for them to get back at the British.
I think that the people here actually originated the term no taxation without representation. So they were feeling that just as much as anybody.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah, the Kingston and Ulster County had an incredible role. The role of the Patriots here was incredible. Yes. In fact, the minister of the old Dutch church, Dominie Dole, was notorious for his sermons, which were all about patriotism and liberty and independence. And that was one of the main reasons that when the British came, they made a beeline for the old Dutch church as well as the courthouse because of what happened there.
I mean, Kingston was called a nest of rebels, and that's just what they were. So.
And some would say we still are.
Do we have any other questions? Anne, thank you so much. That was wonderful. And as Anne says, it was incredibly important, the turnover from the Dutch to English. And very rarely I think you find such a great treasure that was won without a shot. Really the English. I'm going to just turn it off. Everyone can hear me, correct? That's all right. When the English came into New York Harbor, without a shot, they won what became New York. So while we think of it as really a bloodless coup, it really wasn't, because as Anne alluded to, the problems that came in certainly the community here, and I'm sure it was probably reflective elsewhere, there was immediate conflict between the new English troops and the Dutch settlers. So what you have is eventually the disbanding of the English troops and their settlement and relocation to Marbletown. So it has a dramatic impact till today. So it really is, as I said, it's a signal event in our history and one that is really being overlooked. And Anne truly is a one-woman talking tour to keep this up. And it was her idea to do this tour. And we thank you for that, Anne, because it is important. It is something that we should commemorate. So again, thank you very much. And again, as always, we just want to take an opportunity to thank all the people who make this this possible. Again, Anne and all the speakers, it really has been wonderful, the amount of participation and the willingness for everybody to come and share their knowledge with everybody. Again, we always have Bob and Gene Rizzo who do the video displays and help hand things out. All the people who have publicized this, we have a Melissa there, Hugh has been here since the beginning, and all these others. They're the reason that you may have heard about this. So we thank all of them. The members of Kingston's Buried Treasures, and Joe Tantillo. Joe Tantillo puts together all of our PowerPoints and the flyers that I send out. And again, as always, JK Wine and Liquors, they seem to be always happy to give me the bottles of wine to bring up here. So we thank them. And most importantly, again, all of you, you make this worthwhile. I can't think of any place where, any community that has such a wonderful group that appreciates the history of your home and is so knowledgeable. So really, you make this worthwhile, and again, you deserve the greatest thanks, and we thank you very much. I do want to tell everybody about our upcoming events. Next month, September 19th, we have a very special presentation. We are going to be honoring two people from our community that we owe a debt of gratitude that we could never repay. The subject is Christopher Tappan, who the title is Christopher Tappan, Kingston's unsung hero, and he truly is an unsung hero. Christopher Tappan was a brother-in-law of George Clinton. He was George Clinton's deputy clerk for all the years that George Clinton was county clerk. And he was really the one who was running the office. It's debatable whether George Clinton, if he came to town, could have even found the county clerk's office. So Christopher Tappan was the one who did that. He had an incredible role in the independence of New York State and the formation of New York State. And he is really the main reason that our records have been preserved. Our archives at the Ulster County Clerk's Office are really second only to the state archives in Albany, and we really owe a debt of gratitude to Christopher Tappan for that. Our presenter is our current county clerk, Nina Posupak, and Nina is truly another one of our unsung heroes. Nina has played such an incredible role in our community, and she really has made our records available to the public. She has been so wonderful. So again, it's going to be a wonderful opportunity to thank two people who deserve our thanks more than we could ever let them know. And on October 17th, the subject will be the burning of Kingston, the Phoenix Rises. We're going to be commemorating the burning of Kingston. And Hank Yost, who is the member of the first Ulster Militia Reenactors, will be here to do that. He's going to be in full garb and full regalia, and so it will be, and he's going to tell us all about it. So it's going to be a wonderful event. And I do, before we leave, want to let everybody know that we finally have Ed Ford's Lunette dedication ceremony set. It is going to be September 6th, 2014 at 1 p.m. at Kingston City Hall in the Common Council Chamber. We hope all of you can attend. You have all made this possible. And again, it's a wonderful opportunity for us to thank somebody who does so much and asks for so little. So Ed, we are so glad to be able to do this for you, and I hope everybody can attend. So again, we hope everybody can make it to that event. We hope to see you next month at our presentation. And I hope everybody has a wonderful weekend. Thank you. And again, Anne, thank you so much.